To Bethel United Church of Christ. Whoever you are and wherever you are on life's journey, you are welcome here. Happy Mother's Day to everyone gathered today to worship. We are glad you are here celebrating this special day. And now let us prepare our hearts and our minds to worship God. Well, come, let us focus our hearts and minds on God, who came to us in Jesus Christ to love us, forgive us, and grant us new life. We seek God's peace so that we may lay aside fear. We seek to hear the word of God so that our lives may be transformed. With the faithful in every time and place, we praise and honor God Most High. Would you please join me in prayer? God, be present with us as we worship today. Help us to find meaning and new purpose in your word, in prayer, and in music. Free us from self-indulgence and self-deceit. Set our hearts on fire with love for you, and send us out in peace and joy. Amen.
Well, in this time of the service, I always like to say a word to any children who are watching, just as we would if we were gathered in the Bethel sanctuary. And today is a special day. I hope all of you are doing something to celebrate your mother today. And in the church, it's also a day where we take the time to celebrate the many names of God and the ways that we imagine God to love us and be with us. And I have a story to share with you called What is God's Name? And it starts out, after God created the world, all living things were given a name. But no one knew the name for God. So each person looked for God's name. The farmer called God Source of Life. The man who tended sheep called God Shepherd. The tired soldier called God Maker of Peace. The woman who took care of sick people called God Healer. The young woman who nursed her baby called God Mother. And the young man who held his baby's hand called God Father. And the children who were lonely and missed their friends called God Friend. All the people called God by different names, and each person said, "My name for God is the best," but no one listened. Then one day, all the people came together. They knelt by a lake that was like a mirror. It was like God's mirror. They looked and saw their own faces. They saw the faces of all the others. And at that moment, the people knew that all their names for God were good. And all at once, all together, they called God one. God heard and was very happy. Well, let us sing now together happily. Sister, let me be your servant. And now is the time in our worship service where we pray together and we lift up joys and concerns that we might share them with God and with each other. I have several joys to share with you. First, a wonderful joy that Bethel volunteers came together last Saturday to do some work around the church. And we thank them for getting out and helping keep our building safe and preparing it for spring. I'd like to particularly thank Jim Karwowski, who was the leader in this effort, and also Chris Babowski and Todd Keenan. Another joy that all of our doctors and nurses and chaplains continue to labor under such tough circumstances, labor together to help us through this pandemic. And we pray for all of them, and we particularly pray for Kim Paskey, member of our church who has just volunteered to go and work on the COVID unit to give the nurses that have been working there a break. Some concerns to share with you today. We continue to pray for Camden Feely, who celebrated his three-week birthday. He remains in the hospital for one more week, and we pray for Camden, and we pray for his parents, Brett and Megan. We pray also for Tom Tyler's brother, Mike. He was approved for a second transplant. And as he goes through the surgery and starts the long journey to recovery, we pray for Mike and for his family. We also pray for Lori Honer's sister-in-law's mother, Epifania, who passed away just this last week from COVID-19. So we pray for all of that family as they grieve and remember her. I now invite us to join together in prayer, where we lift up these joys and these concerns, and also the joys and concerns of our own hearts. Let us pray together. Gracious and loving God, we praise you for how radically inclusive you are and your love for all people. Through Jesus Christ, you offered your own life for the healing of the world, and your arms outstretched on the cross embrace us all. This great love challenges us, God. Help us to live up to that challenge. Forgive us when we find it hard to forgive others.
Help us to reach out to those we find difficult or disappointing. Teach us the way of mutual respect. Loving God, we pray today for our deeply divided world. We pray that our state and federal governments would work effectively across partisan lines. We pray that they might value the common good above all else. We pray that they might have courage and wisdom. We pray, God, for all who are grieving. We ask that you are with them and wipe away their tears. Help them to hold on to a vision of heaven, and that you will never leave them orphaned. We pray for all people affected by COVID restrictions and limitations. Help us to work together to endure shared sacrifice. Keep us ever mindful of those who are hit the hardest. Pray for all those who have lost their jobs and struggle to feed their families. God, we ask not for just lighter burdens, but also stronger spirits. Be with us and give us the courage we need. All these things, God, we lift up to you, confident that you hear our prayers and care for us all. And now we pray together as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Well, we share scripture today from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 14, verse 22 to 33. Now, immediately after Jesus had fed the 5,000, he made the disciples get into the boat and go on ahead to the other side while he dismissed the crowds. And after he had dismissed the crowds, he went up the mountain by himself to pray. When evening came, he was there alone. But by this time, the boat, battered by the waves, was far from the land, for the wind was against them. And early in the morning, he came walking toward them on the sea. But when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were terrified, saying, "It's a ghost!" And they cried out in fear. But immediately, Jesus spoke to them and said, "Take heart, it is I. Do not be afraid." Peter answered him, "Lord, if it is you, command me to come to you on the water." Jesus said, "Come." So Peter got out of the boat, started walking on the water, and came towards Jesus. But when he noticed the strong wind, he became frightened, and beginning to sink, he cried out, "Lord, save me." Jesus immediately reached out his hand and caught him, saying to Peter, "You of little faith, why did you doubt?" When they got into the boat, the wind ceased, and those in the boat worshipped him, saying, "Truly, you are the Son of God." May God help us to understand these words of Scripture. Well, if you have been feeling a bit weary this week, a little discouraged, maybe a little stir-crazy, you are not alone. Take heart, my friends. As the historian George Kennan once said, bravery is simply endurance for one moment more. The story from Scripture today touches on this challenge of enduring setbacks and facing discouragement. We hear of the time that the disciples do exactly what Jesus tells them to do, and yet still end up storm-tossed and adrift in the Sea of Galilee. The story begins with Jesus telling the disciples to go ahead by boat, and he'll meet them on the other side. But as Life often does. Things get complicated. It's not smooth sailing. It ends up being much harder than they thought it would be. And they run into trouble in the form of an unexpected storm. Battered by the waves, against the wind, far from shore, the disciples fight all the way through the night to get to the other side. Now you should know that the Sea of Galilee is not a massive body of water. It's never more than 7 miles across. Yet they are not able to traverse it, for the storm has so battered the boat, it just keeps pushing it back. So they feel like they're never making any progress. At last, in the early hours of the morning, before dawn, they see something very frightening, a figure walking towards them on the sea. And they say it's a ghost. They don't know what else it could be. Their fear is no doubt compounded by their fatigue and their weariness and their wish to just get out of that boat. But then the figure speaks to them and he says, "Take heart, it is I, don't be afraid." And by that they see it is Jesus, always offering words of peace and reassurance. And Jesus calls Peter out of the boat and onto the waves. And Peter, on the basis of all his past experience with Jesus, follows him. And I want us to pause right here to talk about his decision to step out of the boat onto the rough sea. It's a crazy decision when you think about it. He's scared of the storms, scared of the sea, scared he's never going to get back to shore. And then he sees a miracle, Jesus walking on the water, and he tells him not to be afraid. And his reaction is to step out onto the waves with Jesus. And I love this story, but I don't always love some of the ways that people interpret it. Because you could hear this and think, well, faith must mean putting yourself at risk, just like Peter did, stepping out of the boat, ignoring the risk, doing things that defy common sense. You could read this story and think that the message is that if our faith is strong enough, no harm will befall us. No harm will come to us or the people who we love. If our faith is strong enough. If we have enough faith, common sense, practicalities just don't apply. I can walk on water. Regular precautions don't apply to me. I don't need a seatbelt or a face mask. I just need faith. And I want to suggest to you that that kind of thinking is not really biblical faith or being fearless or even being brave. To me, it's more like magical thinking. It's the belief that one's own thoughts and hopes and desires and wishes can change the reality in front of us. Magical thinking usually gets us in trouble. Because as important as our thoughts and desires and hopes are, they don't change reality. Magical thinking is very common in young children. Those of you who have young kids know what I'm talking about. I always think about my son Eric when he was a toddler. He never stopped moving. He loved to climb. And his favorite thing to do when we went to the playground was to climb to the absolute highest point on a play structure and then, without warning, jump into thin air. And at the time, we said it was fearless, but that's not what it was. People who are really brave, they're the people who understand risks and do what needs to be done, usually for the good of others. That's being brave. I think about people who are right now on the front lines, in hospitals, first responders, people in meatpacking plants and grocery stores. They're going to work each day, even when they don't want to go, to be brave for others. They're doing essential tasks for the good of every one of us. But when Eric was a toddler, he wasn't brave like that. He just had limited experience. And he had this unshakable trust that his parents would catch him. And it was stronger than his understanding of physics or the height of the play structure or anything else. Thankfully, he gave up that practice of jumping into thin air, not because he hurt himself, luckily, but because he learned that his jumps scared us and that there were better ways to play. He outgrew his tendency towards magical thinking. But under stress, I think all of us, not just very young children, can fall into that trap of magical thinking. And I think that this story about stepping out on the water is not about magical thinking or our wish that physics weren't what they were, our wish that things were different, our wish that we didn't have to take common sense precautions that chafe at us right now. I think it's less about our own faith and more about God's great love for us, even when we act in illogical ways. Think back to that boat on the stormy sea. Out of the boat, Peter goes because he wants to be with Jesus. He wants to do what Jesus calls him to do. So out of the boat he goes, and for a minute, everything is great. Scripture tells us that Peter starts to walk on water towards Jesus. Nothing's going to stop him. But then physics take over, and he begins to sink. And he is afraid, desperately and completely afraid. And I relate to Peter in that moment, because fear is a very hard burden to bear. Fear sometimes makes us think that if we pretend something hard enough, it will magically evaporate. But fear rarely helps us in the end. Fear paralyzes us, but faith in God gives us strength. Fear discourages us, but faith brings encouragement. Fear makes us useless, but faith makes us serviceable to others. Fear feels like hopelessness, and faith is always full of hope. Thomas Long once said that to lose faith, to give in to fear, is to stop looking for God. Which brings me back to the second lesson in this text. What happens to Peter when he starts to sink? When fear overwhelms him and paralyzes him? It's right there in verse 31. Jesus immediately reaches out his hand and catches him. In the end, it's not magical thinking that saves Peter or his great faith. What saves Peter and what saves all of us in the end is that God catches him. That's the center of this story. That's the center of our story. That's the center of the Christian story. When our bad decisions fail us, when we feel afraid and paralyzed, discouraged and hopeless, when we are sinking, God reaches out and catches us. God is there for us, not always in the ways that we want, but always in the ways that we need. And I think that experience of being caught, that experience of reaching out a hand and there being someone to grasp it, that experience of God breaking in, is something that we have to feel as much as we understand it. When I was about 7, my family went canoeing on the Current River just outside of St. Louis, where I grew up. And I didn't have to paddle. My parents did all the hard work, while my sister and I just sat in the canoe, enjoying the scenery. In all honesty, I probably wouldn't remember much about that trip. I was just too young, except for what happened later in the day. The water got rough, our canoe hit a snag, and we flipped. Both my sister and I had life jackets on, but somehow we got trapped underneath the canoe, beneath the water. And I remember how quickly it filled up, and I remember how fast it all happened. And I remember the roaring sound of the water battering the outside of the canoe. And I remember water filling my mouth. And although it must have taken only a few seconds, it seemed like I was underwater for a very long time. And I didn't know words like powerlessness, but I was powerless. I was trapped, and I was afraid. And then I remember what it felt like to have my mom and my dad catch me. Literally, my mom grabbed hold of me and pulled me out from under the canoe. And I popped my head up above water to take a deep breath. And it was the best feeling ever. I have a hunch that's what Peter felt like on the Sea of Galilee so long ago. Jesus immediately reached out his hand and caught him. Jesus grabs hold of us and won't let go. There's nothing that we have to do to be saved in this way. We don't have to earn it. We don't have to swim harder or be braver or have more faith. We just have to trust in the goodness of God. And like Peter, we can step forward, even if the ground beneath us is no more substantial than water. What matters is that we are walking towards Jesus, whose hand is held out, stretched out in invitation, asking us to grab hold so we do not fall. Amen.
Thank you. Please join Nathan in the singing of the doxology.
And now, as we leave this time of worship, take with you this blessing from God. Christ said, "My peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. Let not your hearts be troubled, neither let them be afraid. The peace of the Lord Jesus Christ be with you now and forevermore. Amen."